Thank you all for joining us today. It's going to be an amazing event. So first, a brief introduction to the Hive. The Hive incubates, funds, launches companies. Consists of two parts. There is the Hive Fund, which I'll talk about, and the think tank. So almost every week, we have thought leaders who participate in panel discussions, in talks on two topics, either entrepreneurship, which is the event today, or big data, applications, use cases, data infrastructure, data science. And so how many of you have not been to, how many of you have been to a Hive event before? Awesome, great. And many of you know Pashu, my colleague. So Pashu just had a baby last week, so baby Luca. So next week, my good friend Elizabeth Dwoskin from Wall Street Journal is heading up a panel discussion on online dating. So they'll talk about sort of metrics, recommendation systems, introducing serendipity, vertical dating sites like, you know, gay, Christian, Jewish, old people, and the complexity of all of that. And so this one is going to be in San Francisco at Paris Soma, so I hope you guys can join us. I'd like to thank our sponsors. Pentaho had a table outside, so I hope you had a chance to meet with them. Aerospike, Visa, Teradata, Cloudera, Perkins Coie, our partners, and a special thanks to NetApp, who is hosting the event today. The Hive is a studio to create, incubate, fund, launch companies, all with a focus on applications or use cases of data. Unlike most venture funds, we have an in-house team, a technology team, a product team that works alongside with entrepreneurs to nurture those companies, especially when they're young. And it's across three segments: enterprise, IoT, online. We typically invest $1.5 to $3 million in these companies at the early stage, and then help sort of get them syndicated for future rounds of financing. Those are some of our companies. Two of them are no longer with us. They got acquired, Kosei by Pinterest, Deep Forest Media by Rakuten. Our most recent investment was a company called Snips, which is in the ambient intelligence space, moving AI and deep learning to IoT devices, to mobile devices, where you don't have a lot of resources, so that decisions can be made locally. Please reach out to me or any other Hive people who are here if you're an entrepreneur interested in pursuing an idea. So today's discussion, today we'll, after me, we'll have the moderator will basically lead a panel discussion. And let me turn off my phone. And then we'll have a Q&A session. So the rules for the Q&A session, please use Twitter and the hashtag HiveData. If possible, if you can direct your question to Woz or Hitz or to Lance or to the panel, that would be great. Between Lance and his team, they'll help select the questions. Please kind of go through the process. If you do tweet about the event, use the hashtag HiveData so others can actually follow your tweets. I'm incredibly excited to present this event today. I think Dave Hitz, founded this company, NetApp, along with James Lau, a friend of the Hive, and Mike Malcolm. And run so ably by Dan Wormanowen, who made NetApp a kind of big engine that it is today. And so excited to be here. Woz, I think, needs no introduction. He's the chief data scientist at Primary Data. And founder of the world's largest computer company. So Lance is going to be today's moderator. He's the CEO of Primary Data. Prior to that was president of Fusion.io, which many of you know was bought by SanDisk. And so with that, I'd like to welcome Lance.
Hi, everyone. It's great to be here. A lot of familiar faces in the crowd. We have an interesting night planned. I got to tell you, if the conversation is anything like it was back in the green room, we're going to have a real spirited conversation going on tonight. So a couple of things. I want to first introduce our guests. Ravi did a terrific job. There are some housekeeping things I do want to go through as soon as I do that introduction, so just stay tuned for that. He was the co-founder of Apple. He also was the former chief scientist at Fusion.io, where I had the opportunity to work with him for many years, and now is our chief scientist at Primary Data. He also has a very big passion and speaks about technology and innovation around the world. So it's my pleasure to introduce a man who is very driven about engineering and education, also known as the Woz, Steve Wozniak. Please join us. Let's have you sit one more of them. Put you underneath the picture.
We discussed, you know, I'm obsessive, but well, you know, we discussed it backstage that you would take stage left and I would take stage left.
All I know is I'm on the
best
left.
Plans.
He's the executive vice president and co-founder of NetApp with a drive and a goal to make storage easier and more simple. He's had a very interesting background. He's wrangled the storage industry, and before that, he was a cowboy. Yeah, quite interesting. Now he's become a Silicon Valley icon and a business visionary. Please welcome David Hitz. Welcome, gentlemen. A couple of things. So for tonight, we have a pretty interesting agenda for you. We want to cover, as Robbie pointed out, topics like startups, innovation, technology, and maybe end up with some ideas or what you guys think about where Silicon Valley is headed. A couple of items we should talk about. First and foremost, as Robbie proved, keep your cell phones on. We want all those phones taking as many pictures as you want. We want you to tweet, you know, as a reminder, you know, at hashtag Hive Data. We've got folks that are monitoring all of those tweets. And basically, at the last quarter of our discussion, we're going to try and take as many questions from the audience and get the reaction from both Dave and the Woz. Okay, before we get started, you know, we've talked about culture, we've talked about how to run startups and so forth, and you know, I had an experience at Fusion.io that was quite unique that I'm going to put you guys through. They don't know the question I'm about to ask, by the way. Our SVP of sales had a very unique approach in bringing new folks into their sales organization. He had asked them three questions. We want to be able to go deep into your psyche and get something out of, you know, what sort of drives
you
guys.
These are the three questions he used.
He used. Well, I modified two of them. First question. First question is, what's your favorite beverage? Hang on, hold your thought. Second question is, what's your favorite movie? And the last question, what was the worst job you ever had? So Steve, let's start with, what is your favorite beverage?
I'm gonna gamble, because it varies all over the place week to week, but I'm gonna go with Cherry Coke.
All right, nice, nice. Caffeinated or?
What? I don't care.
Cherry, caffeine, we'll keep you going.
Sometimes, at one point in time, it was cherry, vanilla, diet, Dr. Pepper. So,
oh,
wherever.
Dude. Dr. Pepper.
Yeah. Oh, have you seen the new Coke machine where they have like 7,000 combinations and you can push every button and see what kind of mixture you come up with?
And currently it's cream soda, believe it or not.
Excellent.
That plain. But
vanilla, the
but
most
it changes, but it
complicated flavor known to man, right?
Yeah, that's a weird question. Boy, I'll tell you. Did Jim really ask that question to people?
No, he didn't. He asked what the favorite beverage. So, Dave, what was your favorite beverage? Oh. So, wait a minute. As everyone walked in, I'm sure you saw a few beverages hanging out there on the table. I'm sure I can guess which one's yours.
My brother is a winemaker.
Ooh.
And so I got to go with wine, followed closely by tequila.
Ooh. He's a rebel, folks. Just give him a few tequilas and see what happens. Okay.
That explains why you didn't want to be creative. We were talking.
I wasn't ready yet.
Well, I was telling him that Sheldon on The Big Bang Theory said that if you have to go to the bathroom, you're much more creative. But he didn't want to be creative. He wanted to go to the bathroom.
Wait, I wanted to be creative
for about 15 or 30 minutes. I didn't want to be creative for 90 minutes using the bathroom technique.
Okay, what was your favorite movie?
Blade Runner.
Ooh, Harrison Ford fan. So, science fiction.
Wow, for me it went started
wait,
out
wait, wait.
With...
I'm sure it's not the movie where Ashton Kutcher was kind of the lead role.
That's by far correct. That's correct. Well, wasn't, but it could have been a great movie, but it wasn't. But I know The Sting was my favorite movie for a long time because I love playing tricks and jokes and tricking people to this day. But then it went through a lot of other movies. It was The Matrix for a while. But then I think Slumdog Millionaire. And to this day, I'm sorry, it's Silver Linings Playbook. That's my favorite. Every time I watch it, there's so many parts of that movie that have relevance to my life.
Very nice.
Including the dancing.
The great experience was to hear, as the team grew, the kind of culture that was developing based on people, right? And so I think the audience would be quite interested in knowing, you know, as co-founders of pretty successful companies, what was that culture like? What did you like about it?
Is that question three?
That's for the both of you guys.
Okay.
Well, you know what? When we started Apple, we didn't exactly have the culture of a big company, but we felt the few of us that were there, one, it was important to hire professional people who knew what they were doing, not to remain just a couple of kids. And we also had this feeling that we were on top of a revolution, that we had a great product. It was going to be the seeds of making something important in the world. So for the first 2 years, almost nobody ever left. I mean, we felt that we were something important in the world. And I don't know if that's the culture that remains today, but I'm sure
it's a big
seed of it. Yeah. And we, yeah.
Okay, so what was the worst job you had?
You asking me the worst job I ever had?
Yep.
You know what? I don't think I've ever had a bad job in my life. I've had very few jobs. I've worked for very few companies, and they were all just wonderful and great. I mean, everyone. I mean, I had jobs that paid very little, you know, washing dishes in a girl's dorm, but that was fun.
Oh, that sounds like a great job.
In the girl's dorm.
Yeah. And then ever since then, just tech jobs, and that's what I would have been doing, even at Apple. I would have been doing that if I didn't have a salary or a job. It's just what I would have done for fun.
Nice. Yeah,
lucky. So I have never ever had a bad job or one that I said something bad about that I can remember.
Fantastic. Dave, you know, after reading your autobiography.
Pregnancy
I'm
testing.
I'm sure he's got some interesting. Oh, yeah.
The answer is pregnancy testing. And I will tell you, I won't give you too many details. I will tell you step number one is you put on a plastic glove that goes up your entire arm. You've done this. And then to test for pregnancy, now I'm going to try and be delicate about this situation. You don't go in the entrance you'd think because you don't want to introduce bacteria to the calf. And so you go in a different adjacent entrance and feel around.
Okay. I don't know if I can touch that one, guys. Hey, wait, is this rated PG or?
I was careful.
Like, do you know how you circumcise? Joke.
Do you know how you circumcise a whale?
Carefully.
Foreskin divers.
I told you guys, it was worse in the back room.
Okay, moving along.
Moving along. Let's go back to that culture question. I want to throw out a particular value that you know that when the company was maybe at the early stages. You know, what did you see in your culture that that you liked or disliked?
Excellence.
Got to be controversial,
leadership.
Right?
You first?
When we were teeny, and I'll talk about stages of culture because I think it grows. When we were teeny, our culture was very much like a professor with grad students.
Oh.
And the first CEO, Mike Malcolm, had been a professor at Waterloo, Stanford PhD, and it felt like that. And I have to say, it was an awesome culture for small product development, and it fell apart, in my opinion, as the company scaled and skip-level management and all of the normal things you start to get to of how do you run a business. And so it was an awesome culture as a startup, and it was a shitty culture for attempting to grow.
It's interesting, there are points where a company has to pivot. Sometimes they pivot their business, sometimes they pivot their culture, and it sort of grows from there. I mean, Steve, I'm sure you saw quite
sometimes
a bit.
Sometimes they pivot their CEO.
Sometimes they, yeah, we talked about that,
but
right?
Being fast and flexible allows you to follow market changes, too, and keep up
true.
With competition.
No, it's definitely true.
Easier when you're a startup.
When those companies grow, it's a great point. How do you encourage, I mean, what did you guys see? How did you encourage innovation and to keep that path up? So we're talking about two companies that have been very successful that you guys have co-founded, and you had to keep changing and improving. Sometimes there was lows in the business, sometimes there were highs, and you had to reinvent yourself.
Well, in the start of Apple, we had one product that was going to take the company for 10 years on revenues. And when Steve Jobs returned, it was still always an emphasis to try to create something new and better, you know, and make something big that was new and had high quality as a yep. product. And it was a very much a focus on hardware products from day one.
So was there a difference, disagreement between direction that Steve Jobs was looking at and what products you guys were developing, even midstream?
I'm not sure I understand the question.
Oh, you've got
No, I'm serious.
Seriously, what kind of challenges would happen when a new idea would come up or they would see a customer base or they'd see a trend and you were in the middle of developing a product already?
Oh, marketing would shift. Marketing would shift in that direction.
Yeah?
Yeah, we're very much a marketing-driven company. Yeah, marketing would tell engineers to put in chips and money that would slow our products down. You might be laughing. Read my book.
So on the infrastructure side, I mean, Dave, you guys must have seen some pretty interesting changes,
in terms of innovation. How do you encourage innovation? I think the magic happens when you get engineers and customers next to each other, because people have all these fights about should you be a technology-driven company or should you be a customer-driven company? And there's oh, no, you got to be customer-driven. You got to be technology-driven. And to me, that's bullshit, because you have to go find what cool new technology can do. I mean, I remember you talking about what allowed Apple was for the first time you could actually fit a computer on a board and make it cheap enough for a person to buy it instead of a corporation, right? I mean, that's the technology piece. But you got to figure out what problem it solves for. We had a program here for a while where we made the engineers go into the tech support center and listen in on the phone calls, and they came out changed people. Because they'd be like, oh, we got to do this feature, we got to do that feature, we got to do this other feature. And then they'd listen on the phone calls and they'd go, oh my God, they can't even use the features we've got. We've got to make them better. Or they'd hear problems that never occurred to them.
That is so often missed. And also the communication between sales and marketing is sometimes a problem too within a company. But when I joined Fusion.io, and I had kind of 1 year free, I was in my office almost every day, I went on every sales call I could. Yep. I wanted to hear what the customers wanted.
That was a huge benefit for our engineers at Fusion.io. The Woz was able to take that interface with the customer and come back to the engineers who were like a sponge. They had to listen to what was the experience with the customer and what it was meaningful to them.
Another thought I have is ship early and ship often. I mean, it's tougher with enterprise stuff because it's kind of supposed to not destroy customers' data. safety tip. But when we started, we made a big list of all the features we wanted. We want a fancy GUI. I mean, a big list of stuff. And then we could never get venture funding. We actually shipped product just on a series of angels because no VCs liked our product. But it turned out, because we shipped early, it was probably 5 years before we added most of the features on our list of important first product features. That wasn't what customers were asking about. And they had a whole different list of stuff that they wanted. And so if we could have spent 3 more years putting in every one of those features, and when we shipped it, the customer still would have had all that same list of stuff, and you got to get it out there.
But well, I totally agree, because almost every big major successful product category started out with very simple product, not with very many features, and they got added on later, and starting out with the low-cost one.
The iPhone didn't have cut and paste.
But Apple made a lot of mistakes, too, putting out products like 10 years too early, 5 years too early. If you miss the timing because of the price and the value, that can hurt you too.
So how difficult was it to ship the imperfect product first?
Oh, we were out of money. We had no choice. No, I mean, being overfunded, I think, can be a challenge, actually. If you have too much money, you can spend a lot of time building the wrong thing.
Even as an engineer, all my life was getting good at reducing the complexity, reducing the size, reducing the cost, because I had no money. Having no money and not having done it before were the two greatest things I ever did.
You know, you said the biggest spur to creativity is having to go to the bathroom, but I think being out of money is close.
So if you had some advice for those startups, for the folks here that you know are either about to go join their startup, or they're actually in the embryonic stage of a startup, what advice would you have for them? Steve, why don't you go first?
Well, first of all, take into consideration the things that we're saying is important, that everybody says is important in companies. First of all, you've got to have some engineering and some talent that knows how to build it. And you should not conceive your product thinking, then I'll go get the engineering once I have the idea. The idea and some knowledge of building parts and what can be made, people who have spent their life as makers, completing, really developed working prototypes and models of things, should be included in the starting team. And you've got to have the customer support. You've got to have somebody on your starting team that is a customer, that absolutely has lived there and knows what they want, what's good and what's bad. And they've got to be, they've also got to have some good thinking. They can't just have been there. They've got to be like a person who really wants things to be right and not wrong. And like anything works, anything is good, no. And I think that you need those three people. They could all be in one person, or they could be in two people or three, but you'd really need that in a founding team. Because a lot of people have ideas, think they just don't know. Like engineers are taught to think cleverly, solve problems and come up with solutions. And they'll think out ideas that you would have never thought of as a normal, just a business school graduate. So
those
always include the engineers, I say.
So, Dave, I know in your background you had a few startups before you came up with the idea.
I have a theory. I don't disagree with anything you just said. I would add another person you need to figure out. Whose job is it to fire your first CEO? And are you the first one at Primary Data?
I am not, actually. I'm the second one. I think, what did the sales guy say? Don't be the sales guy, the first one on the beach, because you probably have a high probability of not making
that,
it.
the odds that the first CEO is the same, like all the other stuff, hopefully the CEO can figure out, oh, I don't have the three people Woz mentioned, and we'll get this. But when is it time, the odds that that first CEO is going to be the same right person to take it public, to grow it bigger, to all, the odds are really, really low. And it is a very, very rare person who says, you know what, I'm done, time to move on. You know, that's another thing where VCs actually can be really helpful. You get a pile of angels, often none of them will step up to that. Understanding who actually can, doesn't sound like help if you're the CEO, but that is a place where it's important to understand the dynamic. How's that going to work out?
So
it doesn't apply to companies like Apple and Facebook, who were started by people who were self-funded. We funded ourselves, those of us who were in that category, and so we were the shareholders. We ran the board, you know, up to a point in time.
Yeah.
Interestingly enough, to be fair, our starting CEO made the decision on his own because he is the technology visionist and he wanted to take somebody and put him in a role that could take it to the next level.
So it is rare. I'll tell you, our starting CEO, Mike Malcolm, the board fired him. He went on, started another company. It also went public, which says he's a pretty good technologist and company starter. And he's smart, too, because the second time, he fired himself and became the chairman of the board.
Wait.
Right, so it's not. It's a tip.
That's a good
there.
Role. I like that one.
Make three envelopes.
But I can see that. I can see that. I mean, if you're smart, I could see that. Absolutely.
Yeah, I agree.
No,
and
you
I'm
realize.
Not the right person.
You know, I mean, you could argue Bill Gates kind of did that. He had the title CEO, but he wasn't a real CEO. Ballmer was the CEO. He was more like a board member slash technologist.
Yeah, you know about COOs.
Let's move on to technology trends. What are you guys watching right now in terms of a technology trend? What interests you? What are you seeing today that is interesting for you?
Well, number one, outstanding, because it's physical and it's something you actually see and hear about and read about all the time, self-driving cars. But it also brings the elements of artificial intelligence, our machines getting so much smarter, a little closer to what a brain is. We don't quite know how the brain's wired yet, but we're getting so close. And the car has to have a camera looking at stop signs and obstacles and people moving and traffic rules. And that's pretty impressive.
Very
and I think within 5 years, every company's going to have some self-driving cars on the road.
So the smart car.
And maybe another 5 years, they're going to start passing laws that humans aren't allowed to drive on certain roads. No, think about it. No.
The number one challenge of self-driving cars, some futurists say, is lack of organs for transplant. Has anybody here read Robopocalypse? Anybody? So Robopocalypse, 10 years in the future, today in fact, 7-7, all of the self-driving cars decide people are no longer necessary. And what they do is they find pedestrians against walls and smash directly into them. And if you do that first, it turns out killing the occupants is not necessary. But there are a few cars 10 years from now that still won't be self-driving, and so they do head-on collisions with those few cars, which definitely kills the occupants if taken out the pedestrians didn't.
Well, why is this remnants of like Death Race 2000? Fiction. You could make a game out of it.
What?
Death Race 2000.
Yeah, but that's standard. That's standard science fiction.
You don't
thinking.
Believe that model, do you?
And no, I believe the opposite. I think the cars are going to be so much more intelligent than humans. They're going to realize that all of nature and all the parts of nature have to be preserved and protected, and they're going to take care of us humans better than we take
so
care of ourselves.
You're talking about real artificial intelligence.
Yes, I believe that they're going to be. If they're that much smarter than humans, if they only reach our intelligence, they're going to be killing us.
I see a disagreement coming, folks.
Not too much.
What do you think, Dave?
I am donating for the Society for the Prevention of Cruelty to Pets because it won't be long before we're them.
We built all these great computer stuff and all these gadgets to take care of every need and have it done for us, and all we have to know is which button to press, not how to do it anymore, even writing or, you know, thinking or adding or anything. So we're becoming the pets.
I'm kind of jealous of you as a consumer guy because, I mean, I have to say, in the enterprise space, the most disruptive, crazy thing, I mean, maybe in the history of computing, is cloud computing. And the reason I say that, I mean, it's a more, there's a bunch of other ones over history. I mean, the first most disruptive technology ever was the thermos. It keeps cold things cold, and it keeps hot things hot. How does it know?
But there's a joke about a dumb blonde or something saying, how do it, yeah, how do it do it?
No, but cloud computing,
how does it do it?
We've always said, okay, what kind of computer should I own? And with cloud computing, all of a sudden we're saying, how about if I don't own them anymore? Mm. How about if I don't have them anymore? It is a bigger shift, and it's, so I'm very interested in technology shifts, but that one's actually an economic shift. And, okay, you know, follow the money. That one is more radical than, I mean, if you're trying to start companies or figure out, if you don't have a cloud computing component of your strategy, my hunch is you're doomed. It doesn't mean it has to be that. It can be something else, but that's, it's got to be center.
Here's an
it's difficult for those of us who grew up owning our things, putting them in a closet, protecting them ourselves, you know.
You have to let go.
But even, it doesn't belong to me once I put it on the cloud, or have I clicked OK and accept and I've signed it all the way? And
you can't keep your computer in a cage. Open the door, and if it doesn't come back to you, it was never yours.
I grew up in the wrong era.
Yeah, well, look, there's the infrastructure guy, and then there's the consumer electronic guy. That's an interesting intersection point, because on the consumer side, an Internet of Things, it's generating a lot of data.
You want to see my Apple Glass?
I will not say anything about the Apple Watch. Not yet, not yet.
So what do you think about the amount of data that's being generated by these end consumer devices?
Well, the amount of data is so huge, but we used to collect data on hard disks ourselves as consumers.
Yeah.
And they were in our machines, in our computers. And the computer did the calculation and analysis of the data and showed us something off of a CD called an encyclopedia. And now it just sort of has to go out there. Our computers are in the data centers. All the data centers full of huge servers and all that we don't understand. Those are our computers doing the work for us, getting all the information they can from stored up sources of movie listings and restaurants and Uber drivers and everything else. And they're just sending it to us and telling us to display it. But those are our computers out there. No, that's a very, very important part of life that nobody realizes anymore. I kind of gave my computer away. I don't really think about it. It's like you don't think about the workings of a bank. You just know your money's in it.
That's true.
So
how many of you have ever had a Fitbit? All of you are NetApp customers. And the reason you're NetApp customers is because the data flies up through the cloud, goes to the IBM data centers, the soft layer stuff, lands down and ends up on NetApp gear. And you just like, you don't even think of it that way.
But we want two things. We want low cost and we want high performance. You don't want to wait forever for answers. So that means the efficiency of those data centers is really determining your experience as a user of the consumer products.
How many of you have ever been arrested and had to wear one of those little bands that they put on your ankle to make sure that you can't? Turns out that data flies over the internet up into the cloud and lands up on NetApp gear. And so we are keeping you safe from criminals. That is our business.
Are you secure from cyber hacking?
Well, he just told you.
What was the question?
Sure. Yeah, yeah.
I'll give you a new one.
Dave, where do you think the storage industry is heading, and what do you think the sort of the future is? Because this data deluge is a problem. It is hard to deal with.
So, you know, when I think about technologies that matter, you do have to categorize it a little bit. You know, like, are we talking about our bodies or, you know, cities or like, and for storage, the most disruptive technology by far for a long time is flash.
And
so
agree with that.
When I look at storage, the thing that's very interesting to me is the nexus between it was on disk, now it's on flash, it wants to get to the cloud, and then it wants to come back from the cloud, right? Because some data makes sense out there as an enterprise, some data you wanna pull back in. And so that disk to cloud to flash, that nexus, I think, is where a lot of the action is.
I think IDC even recently said that the amount of data is doubling every year, so that by the end of the decade, there's like 44 trillion bytes of data that is being managed. 44 trillion.
The thing I can't get my head around is the amount of data doubling every year because the amount of data is doubling every year, or is the amount of data doubling because disk drives keep getting bigger? And I have a hunch that an awful lot of companies, roughly speaking, have a fixed budget for storage, and every year they keep spending that same amount, and every year they can put a lot more on it. But I'll tell you, if that curve stopped, and every year gigabytes were twice as expensive as last year, we would not be keeping twice as much data for very long.
I agree.
And so there's, it's like Moore's Law. Every year we have twice as many cycles too, and then we try to figure out what to do with them. So I think a lot of data, I mean, people are throwing away data all the time. Lots and lots of data they're throwing away. And as the storage systems get better, compression, deduplication, whatever, then they say, what extra data could I keep and do something useful with? But my personal hunch is it's the dollars driving the total and the technology trend driving the doubling and not some inherent requirement of data.
And it's the same thing for consumers. As much as you have, you'll find a way to fill it up. And so.
Well, there's a couple points.
That applies to bandwidth, too. As much bandwidth as we have, we will use it to its fullest. And it's when there's more bandwidth, we'll come up with ways to use it as much as we have.
4K TV.
So who knows? Yeah, 4K TV. Who knows?
Whatever. That's
in very, very nearby. Of course, you're talking to the person that doesn't have broadband at his home, because I live in the one little corner of Silicon Valley with a horrible phone company that I can't get it. It's true.
But the
so
real
you're
challenge.
Not allowed to comment on your watch, but are you allowed to comment on your phone company?
Probably. I mean, I sat down, I ordered a segment of Halt and Catch Fire TV show last night. It took 7 hours to download.
Wait. Didn't you tell me that to avoid that middle of the night, you'll go over to an area?
Sometimes I drive down 5 minutes from my house to the Apple store in Los Gatos, and I park there, and I've sat there from midnight till 6 a.m. downloading to my iPhone.
Great. You folks are laughing, but it's true.
I am
Don't
so
tell,
glad
I steal,
I'm not
so I
you.
Steal from Apple, yes. My wife does it too.
Okay, Dave, top that one.
Give Janet credit. Give Janet credit. She was the first one that tried to relieve me of the stress.
I can't top that. I just got to go back to the glove.
That's okay. Well, I did sign up for a phone call today from some microwave outfit to try to get higher speed. They didn't call.
What kind of companies do you guys admire? Outside of NetApp and Apple, what kind of companies do you admire?
There was a time I admired Google very much, and now I'm getting a little more leery of some parts of it. Like, Google just wants to make their money by knowing everything about you, whereas Apple wants to make its money by selling good products. So that's kind of how I look at it. But Google was so far ahead towards artificial intelligence and working on how the brain might really work, and a lot of neural network applications and learning machines of the future. And I think that's where the large amount of the future is going to be. Going to be once we crack that barrier and make machines that are conscious. And I think Google's the leader because they handle the most information. I said, okay, we replaced part of the human brain. It used to be you asked a smart person with a brain a big question, and now you ask somebody whose name starts with G-O and it's not God. and you get tons of great answers. We didn't know how the brain was wired. We didn't develop computers or networks or the internet or anything thinking that we're going to replace a brain with it. It's just sort of eventually that's what we wound up doing a lot. And I think we're going to stumble onto consciousness the same way.
Did you know there was a previous generation of brain replacement that started with a G? In bars, people would have these fights about what's the tallest mountain, what's the fastest runner, and the technology that emerged to solve that was called the Guinness Book of World Records. Guinness the beer, because it was for bar records. I just learned that.
Well, I'll tell you though, but as far as brains and smartness, you know, we haven't been able to make a computer yet that necessarily seems to think as smartly as an ant solving its daily problems. And I figured out how you could make the world's smartest cow once. If you transplanted the brain of an ant into a cow, you'd have the world's smartest cow.
Well, you got yourself a cowboy here.
That's close. I just listened to a podcast that had a very interesting observation. It was talking about artificial intelligence, and they said everything that children learn after age 10, computers can do better than children. And everything that children learn before age 10, computers cannot yet do better than children. I mean, walking, have you ever seen those things of like the falling over computers, recognizing things? I mean, but like chess, they crush it. It's just weird that all that stuff that happens early in childhood, computers can't do yet.
We teach ourselves, and they aren't teaching themselves yet. So it's an unfair comparison a little bit so far. Once they are teaching themselves, who knows, they're going to be listening to us talk, and they're going to learn how to speak.
Same as a young baby. Companies that can reinvent themselves. And over time, that's been different companies. I mean, certainly Apple has a good history of you know, now they're the smartphone company. Next year, they'll be the smartwatch. I mean, but fundamental transition. One that is a surprising one, I think, to a lot of people. But if you sit, IBM was in sad shape. And they really do seem to have done a good job, you know, 10, 15 years back of just fundamentally changing who they are. And something that this surprises me to say it, and I'm curious what your thought on this. More and more lately, I am hearing customers think differently about Microsoft. And those guys really whole hog. I don't know if they'll pull it off, but they put a cloud guy at the top, and they seem to be making some interesting bets. And it's weird because they were so much only the evil empire, and now there's like a glimmer of could it be something different. And I think that's one. I mean, we won't know probably for 5 or 10 years, but that's one that I see. I mean, they're trying. Yeah. I admire that a lot.
No, they're taking risks. They're going out in innovative new directions. They're opening things up. And I've been talking to even my closest friends quite a bit that I'm very impressed with both of the two you mentioned, IBM and Microsoft. Those companies are changing, or at least are trying to change in the right ways.
So what about consumer? That's where you often focus. So it's not Google, I heard, right now.
Consumer?
I mean, you know, stuff in daily. IBM, that's so enterprising. but he took that off the table.
Oh.
Outside of Apple and
outside of Apple? I don't know. There's, you could look at Leica technology. I could look at the little reading glasses I have, thin optics. I don't know if you've heard of those, and they clip on my nose and they carry on my phone. I get, you know, lots of little fun things, my 20-cent sunglasses that I like to wear. Lots of innovative things, but that are consumerish. As far as like smartphones and computers and all that, I don't know. Once Apple got to the big screen, I didn't want the others. But I carried them around. I used them. I forced myself to learn a new technology that is not part of my life. I forced myself to wear it in place of what it's replacing for at least a certain amount of time. So I forced myself to use it. And I forced myself to use some Android phones so I would learn what they were about and their features and how, you know, what I couldn't really say honestly was bad about them.
So how long does it take you to get through the security line at the airport with your backpack full of gadgets?
50 pounds of stuff, and I go through TSA pre now, so I get pretty easy. But in the past, it would take sometimes 20 minutes of unpacking it into six bins of single file electronic. All my computer stuff goes on my backpack. I don't check it. One time I checked two iPhones, man. They didn't arrive in Spain until the next day, and sure enough, the iPhones were missing. They arrested the guy at JFK that did it.
So the both of you have co-founded incredibly successful companies. In those early days, when do you think you were onto something big? What sort of gave you that feeling that it was going to go to the moon, that you were on a rocket to the moon?
I was in a computer club, and there were so many people talking about how these small computers were going to change the world, and we were going to be able to communicate faster and educate better, and the geek was going to be important, and I just loved all that talk, and I had my talents of just building stuff, and I'd wanted a computer my whole life. The sort of computer kits they were starting to build, I had built 5 years before, so I was well past it. So I knew that this was going to be something big. It's going to be a revolution. Everyone is going to own a computer someday. I believed it. And the funny thing is, the ideas that I believed it by were wrong, and they would not have come to fruition. And when we started Apple, we had ideas of what people would do with computers in their home. We were totally wrong. We would have lost all our money if that had been all, but it was a platform. Other people out there could come up with their own additions, their own additions, and a software program called VisiCalc, a spreadsheet.
Mm-hmm. I remember.
All of a sudden, small business people could do more forecasting of their business, type in some numbers for January and February and see what the result is in December. They would have taken them 10 years with pencil and paper. They'd buy it. Sales shot up 10 times and there was a market. The whole
personal computer.
That's
another example of the ship early, ship often. You didn't have to be right about everything. You just had to be right about the general direction and then adjust.
But once the directions took off, we were able to shift pretty quickly and address it.
Yeah, absolutely.
But that's also an advantage of platforms and open. That's an open idea. If you're open to other people, like people ask me, what's the greatest product from Apple ever? And sometimes I might have said the Apple II or the iPhone. I might have said different other products, but let's say it's the iPhone. No, it's the third-party App Store. Once Apple opened up the App Store and all the Uber type ideas, the thinking that people had, and reservations to movies and restaurants and flight check-ins and hotels and all that, my whole life winds up being the third-party App Store, and it wasn't part of the original iPhone. So that's my answer.
Yeah, that breakout. You know, for me, I don't remember this, but my mom told me this story. We first talked about NetApp. Mike Malcolm called up me and James. So he was the guy with the idea who said, hey, I'm going to call two other guys. And so that was December 2nd. And I went home for Christmas. I lived here, and my parents lived in Virginia. And my mom told me that after one of my phone calls, so this is, 3 weeks later, she remembers me saying, you know, I'm thinking about this, and this could be really big. And but back then what I thought was really big was like up revenue of $100 million.
Yeah.
Not revenue of $6 billion. So it is like, but still, it was just like, it wasn't consumer and it wasn't like change everything, but I certainly had a sense we're doing things enough differently, this could really change how people think.
When we started Apple, I thought $1 million is really big. But I wasn't after the money, just the product. But
both your engineers, right? Both your heads down, making these kinds of products and new ideas. You know, was there one idea that you thought was super unique that could take the company the distance?
For us, snapshots, the ability to take all of the data that you have and make a magic copy of it that doesn't take up any space and you can look at it later. I mean, that, looking back, so much of our other technology was built on that. You can mirror the things, you can revert back to them, you can clone them and do test and development on that. I mean, so many things are built on that one little insight. I think other companies had done things a little bit like that, but I don't think everybody made it such the foundation of their architecture and then built so much stuff on top of it. That for us, I mean, what would you say
for
it was
us,
early
well,
on at Apple?
Well, our entire product that was going to be the heart of the company for 10 years was done. It was done, it was demonstrated, it was even done before Steve Jobs saw it and shown to others. So it was, my engineer friends at Hewlett-Packard said, this is the best product I've ever seen. We knew this one was going to be so big. I mean, bringing color to the world, making game software. That was the first time games became software, arcade games.
Are all the things you ever built that good, or was that a lucky
one?
No,
they all were. They all were. Well, even back to elementary school, they were. And I had a reputation at HP that if the HP Labs PhDs wanted something done in less than 57 transistors, they would call our calculator division, and I'd work on it for an hour and give them an 11-transistor solution. No, I was just that was just my thing. I just wanted to build. For 5 years, I've been building projects just for fun. And Steve Jobs would come into town about once a year, and he'd see it, and he'd always turn it into money because he needed money. He had zero. But that's part of that's part of what drove us even to start a computer company. He didn't say start a computer company. He said let's start a company to build a part of your computer that people are building. I'd already given away my designs. We'll build a part of it for $20 and sell it for $40, because he'd worked in selling computer parts. Mm-hmm. So it evolved into a company. We had no money. When you're young, you gotta work with what you have. Like, did you start in your house at all? At least your thinking was your work. Your initial
Not
thinking
my
was in
house,
your house.
Mike Malcolm's house.
Yeah, somebody's house.
He turned his garage into a nanny room that then they didn't have a nanny, and that's where we worked.
And seven of our first 10 contributors to the Apple design, the early Apple computers, they all went to the same high school. So, nice. You know, that's how it happens when you don't have anything.
So you guys have both authored autobiographies and documented pretty well, you know, kind of some of the lessons learned. Is there a single lesson that you'd like to tell the audience and the entrepreneurs that are out there that was something that you learned that's kind of unique, that because history tends to repeat itself and there's a lot of startups that make it, some have failed, probably with the same problems. What do you guys think?
Not in that regard, but absolutely find a way in your life. You got to set your personality, though, by the time you're about 20, because it stays for life. Have a personality where you're going to enjoy work. You're going to have ways to bring a lot of fun and entertainment into your work life.
So hang on. How many people here are less than 20? Good. Yeah, you're all doomed already.
23. 23. I'll go for 23.
So you and I went on different paths because I ended up going, you know, started managing people, ran engineering, which is not the path you went on. But
no, I said we'll start Apple, but I'll remain an engineer, period.
Yeah, nothing so else, you and I just very different paths. Here's the single best lesson I learned, and I learned it from Tom Mendoza. Tom Mendoza was our head of sales for many years. Now he's the vice chairman of NetApp. And he was awesome at giving advice, and he was not a numbers guy. I mean, I completely would trust him, but if it involved numbers, I don't think he could have escaped a paper bag. I mean, completely. But whenever I talked to him, I just always found helpful advice, and so I decided to try and reverse engineer the questions he was asking me and what it was that he was doing. And so for any management problem, here's Tom Mendoza's algorithm for success. Question number one, who owns it? Because if you're a boss, the answer is not you. It better be someone else. Because if it's you that owns it, then that means you're busy because you're a boss and it's not going to happen. So who owns it? If you can't figure out who owns it, there's your problem right there. Question number two, do you trust them? And, you know, it's trust defined broadly. Like, you may really, really trust them. Like I just said, I trust Tom, but if it involves numbers, I don't trust him, right? So do you trust them, like, not only that I trust them as a person, but I trust them for this particular job? That's question number two. And then question number three is, if I can't figure out who owns it and or if I don't trust them, how do I find someone who can own it who I trust? And I actually, even though Tom knows nothing about computers, I watched him apply this algorithm recursively. He got to step number three. I don't trust that person. How can I find someone I trust? He said, okay, who owns that? And then it was HR, and he trusted our VP of HR. So even though, idiot savant, he discovered recursion on his own. First sales guy ever. Nice. That's...
You know,
hi, Tom.
You know, as co-founder, you had to have that trust, right? And there are roles, sort of natural roles, that fall between those, sort of the yin and the yang. You and I talked a little bit about this, that my experience was you had the technologist and you had the business savvy person. You had to have those two together. It's very difficult to find someone who could actually do both.
Tom Mendoza told me a joke.
Yeah.
The joke was, so the marketing guy comes up to the engineer and goes, I got this great idea. Everybody hates wallpaper. We're going to have this new kind of wallpaper. You just walk up towards the wall with it, and it just like sticks in just the right spot. It attaches perfectly, no wrinkles. We're going to make a boatload of money. And the engineer says, oh my God, that sounds awesome. How does that work? And the marketing guy says, that's where you come in. But there's a point of that story. The point is, you mentioned three people you need. I think you need a strong technologist who really understands what's possible with technology. You need a strong market visionary. What do customers care about and want? And then you need a management type who can do schedules and make sure there's enough money and enough people and figure out when. And if you're missing any one of those people, like if you've got the marketing guy and the manager type, you will get a product scheduled on time that would be awesome, except it's stupid and undoable. If you get the marketing guy and the engineer, but no management type, it'll actually be a really cool product, and it would have solved important customer problems, but you'll never actually ship it. And if you're missing the marketing guy, you'll end up with a calculator wristwatch. Right, or I mean something. It's like, it's really cool, it's awesome, but nobody, and it's on time, and it works. But nobody wants it.
We've agreed on the three categories, except that I cover businessmen, technologists, and real customer. You're talking marketing. We know what other people will want. It's never as good as what I will want myself.
Yeah, real customer.
Build it for yourself. When you build something for yourself that you want, it's just so much better than I'm building it for who I what I think the world wants.
And you know, over time, you're going to need IT people and finance people, and then all of, there's all this other stuff. But to me, especially getting started, those three things of business sense, management sense, the sense of the customer, talk to them, listen to them, get them, and the technologist.
So what I hear is that there's a lot of influence in your careers, and there are folks that have mentored you, you know, collectively. What are some of the attributes you would mentor to the folks that you've helped? What are some of the key things that you would that you have found helpful in guiding these folks?
So I ran engineering for 6 years, and at the end of it, I fired myself because I didn't think I was a good manager. So I don't know. I'll have to think about that. What did I mentor with people? There's a book called, I can't remember what it's called, but they talk about all of the different characteristics that you'd like in a good leader. You'd like him to be smart. You'd like him really to know the business. You'd like there's a, they had a list of seven or something. But they said the only one that you couldn't cover by getting other smart people to help you, the only one was that people believe in your credibility. They believe that when what you're saying is actually the thing you believe. I think that is so foundational. Anything up, Tom's fine. He can find someone to do the math for him. And I'm fine. I can find people I trust to manage better than I can. But if you don't have that, the people just believe the thing you're saying. I think that's the center.
When I hear the word mentorship, I think of kind of old, young, or experienced person who is guiding the way, sort of like paying it forward a lot of times. If somebody helped me when I was young, I'm going to help these youngsters who don't know their way as well. And maybe they're very young. The young people who just come up with ideas that nobody else would think are going to be worth a lot of money, you know, the Facebooks and all that. But we were lucky in Apple that our investor, Mike Markla, was a key mentor. And he sat down with Steve and I. We were just young kids in our 20s. Wasn't like you see in the movies. And he explained to us, here are the roles that you hire in a technology company, and here's what their responsibilities are, here's how a company works, really. And without him, we wouldn't have, you know, you never hear about him. He had as much stock as we did, but the agency wrote a story of two kids in a garage.
Do you ever hear in your head what Steve Markla Mike Markla today would say about, say, primary data, just kind of going, oh man, we're on. Here's what he would say about what we're thinking of doing. Or do you ever like sort of hear that voice?
He was so marketing focused. He was really the trainer of Steve Jobs, who picked up a lot of the marketing ideas very quickly. So I think he'd be looking at marketing from the market view. But I don't know. He was so much into the consumer end of computers. He had retired from the rat race. He had worked at Intel. It's a regular job, and he'd really retired and was looking around for something interesting to do. So I don't know if primary data out in the enterprise space would be what he'd say. I can't really tell you.
Yeah. The reason I asked that was just, you know, when I think about mentors, they get stuck in your brain. I mean, Dan Warmenhoven was the CEO here for so many years, and you know, there will be times, even if I'm not talking to him, I'll just see a situation and I'll be like, I know what Dan would say about this, right? And it's almost like I'm running a little simulation. I knew him so well. I'm running a little simulation in my brain of Dan Warmenhoven. I didn't necessarily learn it all, but if I actually stop and think, or Tom thinks so completely different than me. I mean, I'm an introverted engineer who, you know, and Tom is complete sales opposite. If I just go, whoa, 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 I'm shitty at this, what would Tom say? Like that, I think having those kind of mentors and different ones, or even just people, even if they weren't exactly a mentor, but you can just kind of ask yourself, what would so-and-so do? It can be, it jogs you, it changes your thinking. Maybe it's a form of creativity.
Good mentors are like the best teachers you've ever had in your life. Everybody can think back and remember who they were. And, teaching was very important in my life. I believed in education and my teachers were really giving me great tools for my future. One of the reasons I went back to get a degree after Apple was successful, I had to use a fake name, but went back to Berkeley and my diploma says Rocky Raccoon Clark. It's true.
Here's a lesson. So,
but I felt it represented that whole period of schooling, which really represents my teachers. My mentors.
Your comment about teachers made me think of something, which is, early on at NetApp, me and the other founder, and then we hired another guy and retroactively made him a founder, all three of us thought it was time for our CEO to quit. And or if not that, then the board should fire him. And we went and told the board that. And it took the board a year to decide that we were right, which I'll say, and he knew that. So that was a tense year back at the office. And I remember having a meeting with Mike, and you gotta remember, I was, at this point, I was like 2 years out of college. No, 4 years out of college. So I mean, not a lot of experience. And he asked me, he's like, Dave, why do you think I need to be fired? Why do you think I need to leave? And what I told him was, I think good CEOs have magic pixie dust that they can sprinkle on problems and make those problems go away. And Mike, I don't think you have any magic pixie dust.
And this isn't the guy who turned himself into chairman of the board, is it?
It is. He learned some things. And he, God, did that make him mad. Like, what the hell is he supposed to do with that? But I will tell you, when I watch good leaders, I continue to absolutely believe that good leaders do have magic pixie dust that they can sprinkle on things and make them go away. And the best way that I've ever come up with to describe what that was, and it was your comment about teachers that made me think of it. If you think back in your life, somewhere in your life, I don't know if it was a coach or a teacher or an uncle or someone in your life inspired you to do something you never thought you could have done. Somehow, I don't know. I can think of, for me, it was a particular professor in college. His name was Peter Honeyman, but it was just, he got me to do this stuff I didn't think I could. And that magic of believing in you, encouraging you, pushing you, helping you, if you, like, that is the magic of the leadership piece. Very different from the technology piece, but that I still believe in pixie dust.
A common theme here.
One example doesn't relate to me.
Common theme here is that mentors push you beyond your limits that you have understand about yourself.
Inventors that, push you?
No, your mentor.
Mentors.
Your mentors push you further beyond your limits. It's pretty common.
That wasn't my experience. That was more with managers.
Gotcha.
Or that was internal. It was actually internal in my case. Forced myself to try to do the impossible things and figure out how to do it without knowing in advance. Oh no, very strong life for that. So I was kind of my own mentor for the main part.
Very nice. Well, we're getting near the end. As you notice, our helper came by and dropped off a few questions.
Oh, we got some Twitter ones?
We got some Twitter questions. So great work, everyone. Appreciate giving the input. So I'm going to select a few here that I think are certainly relevant to our discussion. The first one is, compared to your experiences starting companies, what are startups doing wrong today? Is it in their marketing, in their building, or their hiring?
You know what, when the economy's going good, almost every startup has a chance to raise money and get going. A lot of them get going, and that
it's
doesn't
true.
Mean that they're doing good things to look good. So it's very hard to judge, very hard to give you an answer. I just know, coming from my background, I don't like seeing people with that idea. I'll just write down some ideas. I'll quickly raise some money. I'll hire some engineers some faraway country or something, get it done, but I'll get enough money to buy a house in San Francisco, and then I'll move on to my next project. The serial entrepreneur thinking,
right.
Like this is, and it's glorified in a lot of TV shows and movies, but that doesn't result in the great products. I'm going to build a company. It's going to be so great, and it's never going to get acquired. It's going to be of its own for, 30 years. That sort of thinking I don't see enough of.
Okay, Dave.
Among the very young people I'm talking about, the young entrepreneurs.
Time to be controversial.
Here's one that I'm not sure where the sense is right now, but it's something that I've seen a lot of people do, and I think they're doing it too early often. The whole outsourcing global company thing was so big, and we've got a large office in India, and they do amazing work. But I have to say, there is a lot magic in a startup of being so small that you're always bumping into people. And when a teeny little startup explains, oh yes, and we have our 3 developers in India out of our 10 team of 10, and I'm just like, are you shitting me? They should all be, like, never mind India. You shouldn't put any walls in the space they're in. I mean, just jam them in tight. And so it's important, but it's later. Would be my thought on that.
So the interaction between the groups and how fast you can react and make changes.
I also disagree with the idea that, boy, every Silicon Valley company that starts up wants to have, oh my gosh, we want to build a big campus, have everybody very close and local so we the leaders can be tightly connected to everything going on. And boy, I remember my days at Hewlett Packard. I'd fly out to Fort Collins, Colorado, you know, or even Boulder, fly up to Santa Rosa, you know, Corvallis, Oregon. Their divisions were out there. And when I got there, the people had independent thought. They knew that they were thinking for themselves, in charge of their own product lines. And I just felt it was just a better environment, a better way to work.
There well, can be advantage, right? Domain expertise and the opportunity to work around the clock.
Well, HP in those days was very divisionalized.
I mean,
there was
days.
The calculator group and the oscilloscope group and the, you know, and so they but really were almost separate
and
little
no
companies.
No restriction on communication up and down the org chart or whatever. And we made products that engineers use, so the engineers at the bottom were the marketing experts.
I mean, the thing that to me is amazing about Silicon Valley still is you can get almost any skill you need here. And you can either get people full-time. I mean, so we had this issue with our very early with our systems. They worked great generally, but when we went to trade shows, they would crash right and left. And it was a pain in the butt, right? Because that, it, I mean, on the one hand, there's no customer data in it, but and it turned out what it was trade shows have staticky carpets.
Yeah.
And we had this little box that we bought. I mean, we literally went down to Fry's and found a box that we could put a PC motherboard in, and that was our first computer. And I mean, there's no way that we could afford, there were like 14 of us in the whole company, that we could afford to get the person who was an expert at that. But in Silicon Valley, there were plenty of consultants around, and we got one, and he came. This is like the joke about the car, you know, of, well, never mind the joke about the car. But he came in, and what he told us to do was, here's the door, and here's the computer, and bolt a big piece of wire fabric, you know, metal fabric to here, and bolt it to there. And he charged us an arm and a leg to tell us where to put that little thing. But I mean, and it never crashed again at a trade show. I mean, that was, and so the other thing was, everyone in Silicon Valley understood entrepreneurialism. I mean, we needed furniture, and we couldn't afford furniture. And the furniture store is like, hey, if you just promise to get your next set of furniture for me, I'll give you this used stuff for free. You know, it was, and I think there's, other people or places are trying to get that, but there's just something so steeped in the culture, you can do things. I won't say you can't do them anywhere else in the world, but it's just, there's something magic about Silicon Valley with respect to that.
Everybody's always thinking about it. The entrepreneurship thing, all over the world, everybody wants to be their own Silicon Valley, but none of them have as many resources as here. But if you look around the United States, there are other big centers, Southern California, and Southern Florida, and Boston
North
area.
North Carolina, Boston area.
With similar numbers, percentages of people that work for tech companies. So technology can kind of be done everywhere. It's more in the head
Tel Aviv,
than anything else.
Bangalore.
Yeah. Sure.
Yeah. Israel.
A few places.
There's a security, storage. Definitely. Yeah.
Brazil, Mexico.
Do we still have time for another question? Okay, so let's fire off one more. I think this one, it relates to a point that you were making earlier, Dave. So I want to throw this one at you. It says, does storage break Moore's law? I suspect it's probably down the flash memory kind of path rather than the rotating media.
You know, Moore's law is not a law. Moore's law is an observation, and so far it's turned out to be true. Like chips, you know, so the chips a while back, I'll get to storage eventually. The chips a while back stopped following Moore's law because they stopped getting double the bandwidth, you know, double the gigahertz. And instead, they kind of sort of followed it. They started giving you more cores instead, which is good if you want more cores, but it was sucky if you weren't architected, right? That's been a lot of work for us, was to use more cores instead of more CPU. So it's not like there's a law, but it just it keeps coming and we keep using it. Storage has been on Moore's law, roughly a little bit slower for capacity. Storage has not been on Moore's law for speed, right? I mean, you look at disk drives 20 years later, they're pretty damn close to the same speed, and that's why flash is just, so I did some math. Remember old science fiction movies? Actually, some of you may be old enough to have used this for real. You've got the mainframe computer, and you've got the little mainframe computer CPU, and the tape drives, and Captain Kirk says, calculate pi, and then it starts spinning, and the smoke comes out. So I did the math. The ratio between compute speed and those tapes, if you look at today's CPUs and disk drives are way, way, way slower than that. In terms of how many billions of instructions did you have to wait to get a little bit of data off? It's clogging up the whole thing, right? I mean, the performance of disk drives is just killing the whole compute environment, which is why flash is so important.
I know that the Woz has broken the laws of physics. I've seen him go.
Do you follow Moore's law?
Well, as you said, it's an observation. So I follow it as much as I don't have a choice. Yes, do you follow the schedule of sun and night, day and night? Yeah. Moore's Law, I do look at NAND flash being a very important modern day storage media, and we're storing ones and zeros in 8 electrons. That's about as small as you get. You know, you shrink it more, you need more bits of air
correction. So is that a prediction of the end of Moore's Law? I mean, if we're storing electrons, are we going to switch to quarks?
Well, NAND flash is getting close to a limit, but there are other types of storage. Who knows what's going to be.
Quark storage, you heard it here first.
Exceed, but someday I think everybody in technology thinks we're going to hit these hard limits of Moore's Law and not going to be able to make our machines smarter than before, and maybe they will never get as smart as a human brain.
I just hope Moore's Law doesn't stop before then. I want to see the smart machines.
Yeah, okay.
I read a Robopocalypse, so I had a pretty doomsday. I had the doomsday view, but the Woz earlier on, he's like, no, you got to be more optimistic. They will like their human pets. They will take care of their human pets. And I, you know, a lot of people are nice to their pets.
The environment and nature, the smart computers are going to, if they got so smart.
So now I'm newly optimistic. I want to see it.
I don't want to bet on that.
Not your lifetime, probably.
I think we're out of time with that. I want to thank the Woz and Dave for your time today. Also, the Hive and NetApp for promoting this event and NetApp for providing the facility. Also want to thank the audience, participation in the questions and answers. We thank you for giving that information to us. Feel free to hang out and network. Both Dave and I will be wandering around. The Woz has got to hit a plane and go off to his next event. But thank you very much, gentlemen, and thank you, everyone else.
Thank you.